Hi everyone, my name's Naomi Tipping and I'm an illustrator. I'm not used to doing talks like this. Mainly I sit at my desk on my own and don't speak to people all day, and that's how I like it. Tony has worked hard to get me here today. So yes, I've been an illustrator for over 20 years and I've worked, as Kerry just said, for lots of publishing and editorial clients, and that's been brilliant. I graduated from Loughborough University 20 years ago with a degree in illustration. I was lucky enough to start getting work in my third year of my degree, which really gave me the confidence to carry on with my freelance career. I started getting a weekly slot in The Independent, and that was my bread and butter, and then I got monthly jobs for lots of other magazines too. But then I had children 10 years later and I kind of lost my way. I had three girls. The first one I lost my way a little bit, and I stopped sending my work out. And being an illustrator isn't just about being a good drawer, or even not even 50% of the job. 50% is about telling people about yourself and promoting yourself. And I forgot to do that after having child number one and just carried on working for the clients I had. And then I had another daughter and I forgot even more, and I kind of even forgot why I was drawing and what I wanted to do and what I loved. And by daughter number three, I didn't even know if I wanted to be an illustrator anymore, and I didn't know what I wanted to do, or I was even scared to put pencil to paper. So I just did the jobs that came in, but a lot of my clients had moved on and I hadn't shouted about myself enough, and the industry was much more saturated by this point. So 10 years later, and it was COVID, and I did a course by the Good Ship Illustration. If you haven't heard of them, you should absolutely look them up. And one of the people who runs the courses is Helen Stevens, and she is a massive advocate of drawing from life in your sketchbook. And so during COVID, in the lockdown, when I had my three girls at home trying to homeschool and losing the plot basically, I picked up my sketchbook again and started to draw for fun and not worry, not show it anybody, just enjoy myself again and find myself through my sketchbook. So if you want to see more of my published work and look at my books, you can look at my website and my Instagram. But today I'm going to talk to you about my absolute passion for drawing from life in my sketchbook. And how I think as an illustrator or as a budding illustrator that can really help you and fuel your imagination and feed published work and be really good fun too. So I hope that will come across today. So my name is Naomi and I'm a sketchbook addict. So I take my sketchbook everywhere with me. I never leave the house without it. I have a tiny little sketchbook that I brought with you, but I've forgotten to get out, that I take with me even in my running belt with two pencils, so that if I'm on a little run and I see something brilliant and inspiring, I can just stop and draw. It drives my family mad at times. It drives my friends mad. I haven't got that many friends left because I'm always drawing them and they're not too pleased about it. But I just think they're not your people if they won't let you stop and draw on a walk or when you're out for a drink. So I draw wherever I go. This is my old university town of Loughborough. So these are all drawings I've done since I've been drawing every day since lockdown. This is the Bodega. I don't know if any of you ever go there in Nottingham. This is student night and I sat at the bar across the road looking down on the big queues drawing everybody. I draw on holiday. This isn't a particularly good drawing, but one of the things I love about drawing from life is it helps me to see things better. So this dog was called Buddy, and I started drawing him, drawing how I thought he looked, and then after a couple of minutes drawing him, I noticed he didn't have any eyes. And I'd been drawing his eyes, so I got chatting to his owner and he'd had a tumour behind his eyes and he'd had his eyes removed, and he was a gorgeous little dog, but I wouldn't have noticed that normally. So it helps me to see things better, and not just when I'm drawing, in all walks of my life. So since I've been drawing every day, I feel like I can appreciate the pink and orange morning skies better. Spring is more like spring. I can see everything so much better, and that just makes me happy. When I'd stopped drawing, I was a little bit miserable, really. Another reason I love drawing in my sketchbook is I'm never bored. So I commute to Cambridge every week at the moment. I get a 5:40 train on a Wednesday because I'm doing my MA in children's book illustration at Cambridge School of Art. And I love drawing the people on the train. So my favourite models are asleep. My even more favourite models are asleep with face masks on, because they're not going to suddenly wake up and ask me what I'm doing. So some people can't believe that I'll draw the people opposite me on the train, but I find that really no one cares. No one really looks at me. If I'm just using a pencil, I try and think I'm invisible. And if they do, they're interested, and it's fine. Occasionally they're a bit disgruntled. So often my train gets delayed and I'm not bothered because it just means I can get my sketchbook out. This is Leicester waiting room, and I almost miss my next train because I was too busy drawing. So time just flies by when I've got a piece of paper and I've got my sketchbook and my pencils. I draw in the car, not when I'm driving. I draw my children in the car, my husband in the car. This was them all feeling very sad on the way back home from a holiday in Cornwall. And I try and get emotion into my pictures. That's what I really try and capture. I do a lot of running around for my three girls. So this is between club drop-offs. So wherever I am, any spare minute I'm drawing, times when other people might be scrolling through their phone or watching, I don't know, I draw. And I draw and I use my sketchbook to experiment. It's a place for me to never, ever stand still. So if it becomes boring for me, I'll change things up. So in the summer, I decided I would set myself a challenge when I was drawing every day. I would only use three materials. So at the front of my sketchbook, I was just trying out those three materials, and that's all I could use for every drawing I did. I also had a 20 minute, I wasn't allowed to spend more than 20 minutes on each drawing as well. And I use acrylic paints in my sketchbook to mix, but I never paint with acrylic paints. I then match up my crayons, inks, and then take out those palettes with me. So I'm always experimenting with colour. That was experimenting with a limited colour palette in Cornwall. This was experimenting with a different media of just two colours of ink and dipping between the ink pots, drawing out of a pub window across the road at night time, which is one of my favourite things to do. And I've recently started painting. I am no painter, but I think what I love about paint is that I can't paint, so I have to be a lot looser with what I'm doing. So this was my first attempt at painting for many, many years, since A-level art actually, when the teacher told me I was no good at mixing paint, and I didn't try again after that. I'm still no good at mixing paint, but I really enjoy it. So I was too scared to sit on the pavement as I normally do for this painting trip out. I took all my paints and I took a massive tube of white paint. I was about to start painting. I couldn't find the tube of white paint. I'd sat on the enormous tube of white paint, and there it is still now to this day, a big white area of white paint on my car, which my husband says we need to take a hammer to after I've basically wrecked it from painting in it. This is painting my daughter on her first football match on the sidelines. It was very wet and cold, and I really always like to try and portray the atmosphere. She despairs sometimes if they play instruments, and I'll go and sit on the church floor and draw them during a big concert, and she's like, "Mom, please just don't sit on the floor." Obviously the next time I always sit on the floor again. And I love materials, so this is painting again, but bringing in loads of different materials as well and seeing how they interact with each other. Here, sometimes materials don't respond in the way you think they do, and I really love that. That brings me a lot of joy. So this was, I had been talking to a guy who goes and delivers meals for homeless people just down the road from me, and I've been a few times to draw. He'd said it was okay, and this was a really cold night just before Christmas, but I wanted to show the warmth of the warmth between the guy that goes, Kenny, and the homeless people that come and get the hot dinner. So I painted before with like a cool yellow colour in acrylic inks, and I had a black quink filled pen, you can see at the bottom, and I got there and I was drawing, and it was repelling it, but I love the atmosphere it's given it. So sometimes you'll have really happy accidents because of the materials you're using and experimenting with, and that might then feed something in your published work too. You don't often always get the chance to experiment with materials when an art editor rings you, but if you've already done it in your sketchbook, then you're a bit more confident about it. Sometimes I take out bleach in like a fillable brush pen. I don't advise this one really, but it's amazing to try at home if you haven't tried it. If you lay down quink on a piece of paper or any water-based ink and paint with bleach on top, it gives the most amazing effect. And this was messing around with a piece of charcoal. So my daughters were lighting a fire at the allotment, and there was a bit of charcoal from our last fire, so I was drawing with that. And it's just so exciting to introduce a new material to keep things fresh. And in my sketchbook, I play with other ideas that I'm interested in. So I love negative space. So drawing things all around the object you're drawing, but not drawing the object, so that you draw the object in that way. So this is my daughter at hospital, and not drawing the top of her and then adding line after. And I find that a really helpful thing when drawing things I don't like drawing. So I used to absolutely hate drawing cars. And so I would just draw everything around the car and just leave the space for the car and then go in and add the details. And now I love drawing cars because I don't draw cars, and that makes me enjoy it more. So drawing the negative space of the car, or anything for that matter. And I practice in my sketchbook. So I used to be really hopeless at drawing trees. I live in Nottingham, there aren't a lot of trees. And if there were, I just wouldn't include them. So I thought, what I'll do is I will spend 2 weeks just drawing trees. I went to lots of National Trust places. I went to the Arboretum in Nottingham and I just drew trees, and they were absolutely terrible at first, but they got better and better. There's a little guy in there. There's a man who wanders naked in the woods near where we live every day. He's a nudist. And as I was practicing drawing trees, there he was. So he made an appearance. And then I feel like I've mastered drawing trees now. So just a couple of weeks of really trying to face my fears of trees, and I'd cracked it, I thought. But of course, you never have. Something will come along and you might get it wrong another time. You've never cracked it. And if you had, wouldn't life be really boring? So the same for water. Really embarrassing picture to show you because it's terrible, but I couldn't draw water. Every time I drew water, it looked too solid, even when I was using inks. So I set about trying out with different materials. How could I draw water still looking too solid, trying out with squiggly lines, and then starting to get a bit better. So this is the Bingo Dabber, which is another favourite material of mine, just dabbing the Bingo Dabber on and to draw water. And again, not drawing water, so the negative space suggesting water and showing the light reflecting off it. And I'm going to show you a little video now because I find Instagram a really hard place. I think that was where a lot of my problems came when I'd had my girls, was I was constantly scrolling through Instagram and looking at other illustrators and thinking, oh, their work is so good, it's all amazing, but nobody shows that rubbish stuff. And I really try to do that on my Instagram page, to be a bit of an honest illustrator. So I'm going to show you a flick through my sketchbook. I would say there are probably 20 rubbish drawings to every decent drawing. So here's a flick through. I also use sketchbooking to fill my memory bank. So often when I'll get a job, I don't have time to collect reference. So more often than not, it will include children. So I draw my children a lot to fill my memory bank, is how I call it. So now I don't need to get reference. I've drawn children so many times. This was going to a day nursery to draw children, that I can imagine what they look like and how they move. Or I'll think of the little kid picking its nose at story time, and I can reference that without having to go and get the reference. Or occasionally I'll look back through sketchbooks too to look. I think he is actually picking his nose, the boy in pink. So occasionally I will look back and take characters from my sketchbook, but other times they're just in there because I've drawn it. I can recall that and include them in my work. I go everywhere. So I spent a day in a barber shop just drawing, just to fill my memory bank in case one day I need to reference a barber shop or a hairdresser's. I'll have those images already in my head to draw. Drawing at my children's concerts, just in case. I'm currently working on a project about a lonely old man. I'm a bit obsessed with the theme of loneliness, and I had lots of drawings of lonely old men, particularly in pubs, to draw those characters from. So one of the main character from the sequence I'm working on at the minute comes directly from my sketchbook too. I also use my sketchbook as a visual journal, and that's quite new to me since I've been drawing every day. On my holiday, it was the first time we'd taken all three of my girls abroad last summer, and I was drawing every day, much to their dismay sometimes. And I love now looking back at those sketchbooks as a diary. I don't write a diary, but I look at those pictures and they really take me back to how I felt at the time. So I'm really nervous flying and the marks are so scratchy, and I can conjure up how I felt. Like, I can feel the heat looking at this picture. We'd just arrived in Spain and we were driving to where we were staying, and I can remember the smells, I can remember the heat, I can remember what my children were saying. Because unlike a photograph, it's a period of time, say 20 minutes standing on a rock drawing, and you remember everything about it in such a more effective way for me than I do if I just took a photo. So that helps if I'm then drawing a beach, I can imagine how I felt and try and get that across in my drawings. So using my sketchbook as a visual journey has been something, is something new, but something that I've really enjoyed as well. This was a thunderstorm passing over, so I just drew a tiny little thumbnail every minute in the changing sky as the thunderstorm passed over on our last night on our holiday, and then heading back home. Something that also really interests me is using my sketchbook as reportage, so to capture moments in time, and also as a comment on our communities and the society that we live in. So this is a social enterprise not far from me that I've spent a lot of time at drawing, and they sell near end of date food, or just past end of date food, and he opens at 9 o'clock on a Saturday, and at 8 o'clock there's a big queue outside, and I needed to capture that because I think it's so telling of the times that we're living in. This is inside food print, and everybody's just been allowed in and they're scrambling around to get the best bargains. And I love chatting to people. So one of the women I've got talking to gets two buses on a Saturday morning to come to food print to get this reduced food. And she says it's not just for the cheap food, but for the community that she talks to, and just that routine of a Saturday morning. So it's taken me to places that I would have, my sketchbook has taken me to places and helped me to meet people that I would never have met before, and that feels really quite brilliant. This was when the Queen died, and I'd taken my youngest daughter to Primark, and I had to stop and draw everyone laying flowers because there was something quite special about that. I love living in Nottingham. I love Nottingham. And I'd gone down to draw this building site, and when I got there, this little guy was painting over the graffiti, and I just thought that was brilliant, that these buildings were moving up, cars were moving on, everything was moving forwards, and there he was painting this graffiti off. And I went down the next day and it had all been graffitied over again. I should have drawn that as well. And this is drawing at the Refugee Forum, and so I've spent a lot of time here too, and I love capturing those relationships between the volunteers and the refugees, and I've made some great friends there as well. And this is a social enterprise where these two women come every week to cook dinner for the community, and they always make me put my sketchbook down and have dinner. And even I'm like, no, I'm just in the middle of the drawing, they say, no, Naomi, you sit down, you have dinner with us. So I've really made some great friends because of my sketchbook too. And I also use my sketchbook to spark ideas for children's books or editorial work. But this particular idea for this book that I'm going to show you came from drawing at night. I became obsessed with drawing at night, and I would go out every evening once the children were in bed and draw. I loved laying down ink on the page and then just drawing over with like a yellow neo colour and white and red neo colours, and it was really interesting to see how few marks I needed to make to show that it was night time and that things were happening. And so because of that, I wrote a book and illustrated a book called Little Fox in Big Town. And he's terrified of the big town that he lives in and won't come out, and he makes friends with this rat and they go into the big town together in the end, and he helps him overcome his anxiety. But that all stemmed from drawing at night in my sketchbook. So there he is when he won't come out. These are also not very nice drawings, but I set myself challenges a lot. And this was a challenge I set myself for a month, that I would stand on, you can see my feet in that middle one, I would stand on the chair at the end of my dining table, and I would be allowed to draw the dining table from that angle every day for only 5 minutes. And I did that for a month. And I didn't know why I was doing it. I just thought, oh, let's see what happens. And that was a couple of years ago. And then because of that, a story idea came that perhaps I love the idea that everything happens around a dining table when all these people come and go and all those different feelings and conversations shared. And I wondered, could there be a story just at a dining table? We don't have to move anywhere else, but just by changing the angles, would it be interesting enough? So this was a little sequence that I wrote and illustrated about a mum who's got cancer. And she becomes more ill and they make soup, and it's all about centres around the soup and the love between that family and the relationships and how they go on without her. And there's an apostrophe in the wrong place there, I'm afraid. It says an octopus garden instead of an octopus's garden. But this guy I drew at Goose Fair, I actually just was drawing at Goose Fair one night, and he had a giant fluffy octopus. And then out of that, a few months later, I was looking through my sketchbook. I thought, he's great. He looks lonely. I like lonely old men. And he's got a giant fluffy octopus. So I wrote him a story. And he's not lonely anymore, because you can watch the story. There he is at the bus stop on the way to Goose Fair. He falls in love with the giant octopus, because who wouldn't? I'm taking him home. And there you go. Got to wine and dine your giant fluffy octopus. And then I draw in my sketchbook for all those reasons and to feed my illustration work, but mainly, I'm sure you can tell, I draw in my sketchbook for fun. So although it's an important part of being an illustrator, and I do think it's a real crucial thing, it's also great fun, and I see it as a little bit of a hobby as well, so a little bit separate from my paid work that I do as an illustrator. So I love running and I love drawing, and I thought, wouldn't it be great to combine the two? So last spring I started going out running and drawing. So this particular was my first one. My bag was way too big. I now have a much smaller bag. I had such bad backache. This was a 10-mile run I did, and off I go, and I take my art materials, I sit down, I spread all my stuff out, I draw. I'm not allowed to stop more than every mile are my rules. I run again, stop and draw, and that is like my dream day out. My husband said to me for my birthday, did I want to go to a spa? I said, no, can I just go out running and drawing? So I didn't get to a spa, I've still never been to a spa. So yeah, for fun, and I hope that comes across in my sketchbook drawings, that I really have a fun time when I'm drawing. This was on holiday in Cornwall, and we actually missed the bus back up to the campsite because I was finishing this drawing. I love drawing my relatives. This is my auntie, she's got dementia, and I'm currently writing a story about a grandma and her granddaughter with dementia. This is my favourite pub, the Bath Inn in Nottingham, and I love drawing there too. And camping, which is another favourite thing of ours, and at Centre Parks. And I love nothing more than a scruffy street, so I went to Derby especially to draw on this. I didn't know that I'd get a laugh on this scruffy street.
Wow.
And then there you go, that's me. My friend came to take some photos of me recently, and these were the photos she sent me back, and I hadn't quite realised how crazy I looked with all my stuff spread out on the pavement. But yeah, there you go, that's it, that's what I do, and that's what I love. And I would urge you, if any of you want to be illustrators, to do the same and just enjoy it and experiment. There you go. Okay, my name's Naomi Tipping. I'm a freelance illustrator. I work for editorial and publishing clients such as John Lewis, the Labour Party, Hodder, the Radio Times. Yeah, that's it really.
What advice would you give to students that want to break into your industry?
I would say draw, keep drawing all the time, and be you in your drawings. Don't be influenced by what you see on Instagram and what other people are doing. Really be you and think about what you want to say in your drawings.
What challenges do you face in your role?
I think it's a very saturated market. So there's a lot of us all trying to get work. So I think the main challenge is finding publishers, because a lot of them don't accept manuscripts and artwork anymore. So making those relationships and links in the first place is the most challenging thing for me, I think.
Who or what inspired you during your journey to where you are now?
That's really hard. I don't know if she inspired me, but my mum was a constant source of encouragement. She was my number one cheerleader, and she always supported me with my decisions to study art, and really encouraged me. So not an inspiration, but really, really encouraged me a lot.
How was your experience today?
I was very nervous, but it's been fun, and I've enjoyed listening to the other guest speakers as well.